Good morning and happy Easter. Today is Sunday, April 12th, and welcome to our service this morning. I do have a few announcements. You can access the service once it's over after 1 o'clock in the afternoon from our website on our YouTube channel if you'd like to go there and watch it. Today after the service this morning at 11:30, you can go on our Zoom coffee hour. Just follow the directions that were emailed to you or go to our Facebook members and friends page for directions. So we hope to see you there. It's nice to hear voices and see faces while we live in isolation. Thursday morning at 11 a.m. we have another Zoom gathering, which is called Coffee Talk. It's just where people get together and we're able to talk about whatever we like. And again, it's nice to see and hear one another. Also on Saturdays, I post a video that you're welcome to watch on our Facebook members and friends page. It's called Cooking in a Pandemic. And this Saturday, we're actually gonna be making a cocktail. And this is our third Saturday we're doing that. It's just another way to reach out and see and hear one another and maybe inspire you to do some cooking. So at All Faiths, no matter who you are, wherever you are on your spiritual journey, and no matter whom you love, you are always welcome here. Please join in singing Enter, Rejoice, and Come In. Chalice lighting words for this morning. This flame marks our celebration of spring, revealing holy love that grows from deep within our hearts. Our opening words this morning are from the Reverend Elizabeth Strong. Out of the earth rises life, rises light, rises spring. May we join with the miracle this, that is springtime, and enter into life with lightness and joy. Out of the spirit rises faith, rises hope, rises love. May we join with the miracle that is Easter time and enter into this life with hope and with love. Let us resurrect with spring. Let us resurrect with the Spirit and enter into the renewed life as we gather into our time together this morning, this Easter morning. It is good to be together. When we are gathered on Sunday, we share our joys and sorrows with the congregation. But as we are not together this morning, I invite you to light your own candle and meditate or think of your joys and sorrows as we share silence together. Our reading this morning is We Don't Know What Happened by Daniel Budd. We're not sure what happened, but we know what it's like when someone appears whose message we feel offers hope, who inspires us with new ways of living. We know what it's like when they fall short of our expectations, or even worse, when they are cut down by the forces of hate and bigotry. We're not sure what happened, but we know what it's like when someone has grown profoundly into our own lives, who seems as much a part of our living as our own breathing. We know what it's like when death takes them from us, perhaps prematurely, and the empty place now in our souls is much like an empty tomb. We're not sure what happened, but we know what it's like to feel sorrow and loss, despair and grief. We know the waves of tears and the thoughts of the past which flow through us. We know that memories and stories begin to fill the emptiness. Our lives are shored up with a different presence which will live within all of us, all of our lives. We're not sure what happened, but we know what it's like to realize, to have it drawn upon us, that we have known and loved lives on with us, or lives on with us. Love lives on with us and within us forever, being a part of who we are. We know that somehow in our hearts and souls, resurrection is real. Not that of the body, but of the spirit. A spirit renewed, even reborn in the midst of our lives and our living. We're not sure what happens, but we know there is a difficult hope of faith that through whatever sorrow or grief we are feeling, there is also a growing sense of grace and gratitude, of joy and thanksgiving in the mysterious and abiding astonishment of being human. In this wonder, may we find strength within our own sense of Easter. And so ends the reading. Thank you. Today, people around the world are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. Perhaps you're one of them, because the story of Jesus' resurrection offers faith and hope in the miracle of God's love. These are messages people need right now. Actually, they are more than messages, they are promises. Promises made to the people or the characters in the Easter story. When I read the story, I focus on the needs and focus on the reaction of the characters. That is when we can most see the manifestations of the promises that were made. The Gospel of Matthew tells us, after the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, which I find odd that it's written that way, making Mary sound like the other woman, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb, and there was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid that they shook him and became like dead men. And the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said he would. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now," said the angel, "I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid but yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. And suddenly Jesus met them, saying, "Greetings." They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to meet me in Galilee. There they will see me." And while the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. And when the chief priests had met with their elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say his disciples came during the night and stole him away while you were asleep. If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and get you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountains where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always to the very end of this age." And so for some, Easter really is the culmination and the fulfillment of God's promises. It is much more than simply the celebration of a new season. And it stems from the tradition Jesus celebrated as he joined his disciples for the Passover feast. It is the completion of the scriptures brought forth by the prophets outlining God's covenant with his people. It is the sacrifice and death necessary for a new life. It's about moving beyond an empty tomb. And I wonder if you can imagine what the disciples, Mary Magdalene and Mary, felt on Easter morning when they came upon an empty tomb. All of their hopes, dreams, had vanished, and apparently so had the body of Jesus. They are called to look beyond the empty tomb to where there is life. It's not a dead space. It becomes a place for life. The promise of Easter is resurrection. But as Unitarian Universalists, most of us understand resurrection as not the rising of a deity named Jesus, but the resurrection of renewal of hope, nature, beginning again, and for some of us, the Easter Bunny and its pagan roots. Easter still offers promises to us. especially this particular Easter. In our secular view, the term Easter is related to a goddess of dawn worshipped by peoples in early India and later in Roman times. And according to this view, the word East comes from the early tradition in Western civilization of people facing eastward to worship the dawn. The secular festival of Easter was regarded as the beginning of the new year, and remnants of this kind of celebration may still be seen in southern Germany. So spring, the time of sunshine, of flowers, of new growth, of new life, was celebrated as the season giving promise of new life to mankind. If you pay attention this time of year, you will witness all of this in southern Florida, but you have to look closely and pay attention. But more importantly, Easter is a time for new life internally. That is, it is a time for us to consider renewal, beginning again, letting go, throwing down that which binds us and keeps us from living authentically and meaningfully. Easter brings us possibilities. I've been studying the writings of Thich Nhat Hanh recently, and he tells us the best way to take care of the future is to take care of the present moment. And he also says, because you are alive, everything is possible. Because you are alive, everything is possible. And so for us, these are the promises of Easter. Promises of possibility, awe, renewal, self-care, reconnection to all that is truly living. We have more possibilities in each moment than we realize. At any moment, we have a choice that either leads us closer to our spirit or further away from it. In regards to connecting to the living, Thich Nhat Hanh writes, getting in touch with the beauty of life makes it much more beautiful, much more real, and the more mindful and connected you are, the more deeply the sunset will reveal itself to you. Your happiness is multiplied by 10 or 20. My hope for us is that you are beginning to realize and understand the promises of Easter. This couldn't be more helpful given the crisis we are currently living in. And by now, most of us are feeling the effects of isolation, quarantine, rising death numbers, the lack of healing, touch, or the embrace of another person. Maybe your toilet paper stash is dwindling and you're starting to realize what your true hair color is. Those are both stressful situations. And while confined by walls and living our mass lives, there is still the promise of hope, the opportunity to look within, to live more meaningful with gratitude and a renewed understanding for the human connection and compassion that we will likely never forget when all of this is said and done. You see, Easter, this time in our lives, is laying so much before us to become better, stronger, more graceful, more tender, more empathetic, living a life with more clarity and more concern. We need to make a promise this Easter. We need to make a promise. A promise that we will not return to our old ways, but maintain all that we are learning during this pandemic. We also need to recognize that we not only have the responsibility to one another, we have a responsibility to our community as well. As Unitarian Universalists, we are responsible to bring comfort and hope to our community. And so sometime over the next week, a large banner will be placed on the front of our building. The banner will read, "All will be well." And when people in the community drive or walk or run or cycle by our congregation, they will for a moment be reassured. They will for a moment have hope. It is our responsibility to bring both to our community. We must live in this hope that all will be well because the alternative will destroy us. It is important to remember that we are not in this alone. We are enduring this crisis together, and we will arrive on the other side together, Together we'll learn about what well-being means in this new reality we are all living in. Together we'll learn what makes us feel good, what is really hard, how to connect with one another, move our bodies, exercise our minds and our spirits, and look after each other. Together, we'll express our gratitude to the workers keeping our essential services running, to the healthcare practitioners, the workers caring for others in nursing homes, the farmers and field workers, gas station attendants, the cashiers and grocers. While I don't know how long this crisis will last, I do know that I am here as long as we need to be. I know that you are all here for one another, and I'm grateful. Together, we can get through anything, and I love you every step of the way. The promises of Easter, may they be close to you, clear to you, and comfort you. May it be so. If you're watching for the first time, you need to know that before the offertory, I like to tell a joke because I'm convinced that laughter makes you more generous, and we need more laughter at the moment. I'd also like to take a moment to express my deep gratitude for your support of the congregation that keeps coming in. So during religious education, the teacher asked the little girl, "Can you tell us what happened on Sunday?" And the little girl, who is a Unitarian Universalist, says, "Of course I know. Jesus rolled back the stone, walked outside, and saw his shadow. So now we have 6 more months of winter." The offering will now be given.
I'll rise like the day, I'll rise.
For all who are experiencing hopelessness and despair this Easter, may you find in the darkness or depression a doorway to light and warmth that offers you freedom. For all of us, together we can do what no other isolated person can do, rolling that heavy stone away, pushing it aside, which reminds us we are far more powerful together than we could ever be on our own. Our offering of strong hands to help our prayers made real, and let us begin again in love. We will rise up. Blessed be. Please join in the words that we recite together as we extinguish our chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and out into the world.